Okay, the first one on the list is Clarence Meekis. Clarence Meekis. Clarence Meekis. Clarence and family. Run, Clarence, you're late. My mom is on time. Clarence Meekis calling. Oh, there's. Come on. I hope you had a. I hope you had a beautiful night, beautiful morning.
Is Brent here? I'm just wondering about doing the projection.
Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome today. How's everybody? Good? A couple of you? The rest of us are trying to decide yet. It's a beautiful night. Camping out. And looking forward to another great day together today. So we're going to lead some songs of worship. So we invite you to join us. We do have the words available over here, so. So if you're not sure of the words, you can sing along, or you can look at the screen over here. We are from Thunder Bay. My name is Clarence. This is my wife, Karen, and our family. This is our son, Sky, over here. Our good friend, Naomi, from Thunder Bay, helps us at New Hope Church. And then our friend, Elena, our daughter, Rain Grace, and our son, Clarence, Jr. We love to worship. We love to lift up the name of Jesus, and we invite you to join us today as we worship for a few songs. So we're going to sing Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind. You are
grace so amazing it sent the Son of God to the cross. Let's sing I Saw the Light. I wandered to him that's life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in.
I wandered to him that's life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light. I saw the light.
Sorry, we made our thing and it wasn't in order. We're going to sing a song called The River. It's a song of invitation to the river I am going, bringing sins I cannot bear. You know, our Father God has open arms, no matter what our life condition. We can surrender to Him and He will accept us as we are, as we surrender. Precious Jesus, I am ready, is what the chorus says, to surrender every care. Take my hand now, lead me closer. Lord, I need to meet you there.
To the river I am going, bringing sins I cannot bear. Come and cleanse me, come forgive me. Take my hand now, lead me closer.
Come to you as we come to you with open hearts. Let's pray and thank you that you accept us as we are. Thank you for your faithfulness, Father God. We're going to sing a song. It's probably my favorite song. We don't have the PowerPoint for it. It's called The Love of God. I think many of us know it. Probably one of my favorite songs because it really paints a picture through the words of how great God's love is. It says, how measureless and strong can't measure the love that God has for us. And the word pictures that come through the verses are pretty incredible. Let's sing this together.
The love of God is greater far than eternal. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty bread bowed down with death. God gave his son to pay. His erring child, he back and saw. Yeah.
Singing about grace at our church in Thunder Bay, New Hope Church, New Hope Fellowship. We celebrate the themes of grace and hope often, and we want to bring hope to the world around us and show God's grace that's available for everyone. We're going to sing a song called This Is Amazing Grace. It's a bit of a newer song, but I think many people know it.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King of love. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? That you would take my place, that you would bear.
God's own son, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, Holy One. The chorus says, thank you, oh my Father, for giving us your son and leaving your spirit, your Holy Spirit, till the work on earth is done. So we have a gift of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives as we surrender and seek the Father's heart. Let's sing this together.
There's a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, Holy One. Jesus, my
we thank you for this time and this morning together with our family and our friends here, and we just invite you, Father God, by your Holy Spirit, to come and show us your heart today. Come and speak to us as we hear from your heart, as we worship, as we sing, as we pray, all of these things, God, we want to do to your honor and glory today. Thank you so much for this time, God. Just guide us in the time ahead. We love you, Lord. Amen. Amen.
Good singing. Next on our program is the Mountain Anthems Choir. They're from the mountains somewhere. I'm sure they'll tell you where. I think they're going to sing on the ground? Uh-oh, here they come. Okay, welcome to the choir, mountain choir. It's a big mountain. I know that much. Okay, go ahead.
Good morning, everybody. It's good to be here. We talked about the mountains. Well, he's right. We come from Pennsylvania. Some of you probably know where Pennsylvania is at, and if you don't, it's a long way away. If you know Brent Schrock, or if you've heard that name, who works here at camp, that is the area from which we come. There are a lot of mountains in Pennsylvania, and it's a beautiful place to live. It's different than it is here, but we're glad to be here this morning. We're going to sing for a little while, and we will start with the first song called Oh Let the Hills Now Sing for Joy.
Break forth in joy.
of Christian soldiers fighting Satan every day. We're standing up for Jesus while we're kneeling down to pray. If his precious blood has cleansed you and washed away your sin, that makes you a member of the blood-washed band. Praise God, I'm a member of the blood-washed band. I've been washed in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb. I was bound by chains of sin till one day the Master came and made me a member of the blood-washed band. God's children are advancing, marching till we reach the goal. For the battle's almost over, we'll soon be going home. I can hear the sound of angels as the saints go marching in, singing praises to the captain of the blood-washed band. Praise God, I'm a member of the blood-washed band. I've been washed in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb. I was bound by chains of sin till one day the Master came and made me a member of the blood-washed band. Praise God, I'm a member of the blood-washed band. I've been washed in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb. I was bound by chains of sin till one day the Master came and made me a member of the blood-washed band. God's got an army marching through the land. Deliverance is their song with healing in their hand. Everlasting joy and gladness in their hearts. And in that army I've got a part. God's got an army marching through the land. Deliverance is their song with healing in their hand. Everlasting joy and gladness in their hearts. And in that army I've got a part. God's got an army marching through the land. Deliverance is their song with healing in their hand. Everlasting joy and gladness in their hearts. And in that army I've got a part. God's got an army marching through the land. Deliverance is their song with healing in their hand. Everlasting joy and gladness in their hearts. And in that army I've got a part. In that army I've got a part. In that army I've got a part.
I especially like that song because that includes all of us. Here, there, on the other side of the world, it doesn't matter. If we're part of God's family, we're all part of that army. By now you've heard what we are like. We sing a cappella, there's no instruments, no accompaniment. And we will sing some songs maybe that you don't know, but the next one is one that you possibly will. You are my all in all.
Strength when I am weak, you are the treasure that I seek, you are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel, or to give up I'd be a fool, you are my all in all. Jesus,
taking my sin, my cross, rising up, God bless your name. You are my all in all.
While the other hand is leading me as I walk.
a barren land. His eyes can ponder the many wonders of the land, the sky and sea, while at the same time his loving eyes are watching over you and me. He's a great and awesome God. His mighty love and mercy abound. He's a great and awesome God. No greater power on earth can be found. His love endures through all generations, calling to the lost to receive salvation. Upon his name we call. He's a great and awesome God. He's a great and awesome God. An awesome God.
Shed Higher far than the brightest star.
See how it works? Our time is up. Thank you. We will be back again tonight, I think at 7:30, is what's on the program. Hope to visit with some of you later this afternoon. God bless.
Give him a hand. That was beautiful. I hope you were blessed. Really blessed too. Like you said, they'll be back this evening. Everyone, come this evening. Next on the program is a group from Garden Hill, Gospel Harmony. They want to sing Oji Cree hymns. Cree hymns. Okay. We will do the offering on their last song. We'll do their offering. That'll give you a chance to go and get your money. Okay.
Yeah, I was just teasing them. Okay, all right, good morning, everybody. It's good to be back. And this morning we're going to try some Cree hymns, and Norm and a few others are passing around the... can we have a couple here, up here? We're going to give it a go. Everybody's going to get, or most of you will get this. English, pre-English hymns. We're going to sing from we're going to sing about four songs because we want to give Huron some good time there. Really enjoyed his presentations. And also, I really enjoy the singing that is people from Pennsylvania. I was there, I think it was four summers ago. We were out east, going to Niagara Falls, and we've had visitors from Pennsylvania to our community every summer for Vacation Bible School. And there's about 20 that come every year, 25. We got to know them, and so we were out in Niagara Falls area, Toronto area, a few summers ago, towards September or August. Anyway, we were there, and we looked at the map, and we said, "Why don't we go down there and just because we had a few days left?" So let's just drive down there. It doesn't look far on the map, you know. Anyway, so we decided to go and start driving. Well, we figured, okay, the Canadian map and the U.S. map are different, yeah, like put together. And the U.S. map look kind of, I mean, Canadian map looks, you don't have very far to drive, maybe 8 hours, okay? Then we kept driving and driving, and by the time we got to close to halfway, we were worried, I mean, when are we going to get there? So we slept halfways. But anyway, we got there and we enjoyed the visit. And I tell you, it was wonderful. We went to the church there where there's no instruments, okay? Not like this one. Okay, so we went to church there and we had time to do a little presentation. Just thanking them for their ministry. What I explained is, up north, in reserves, reservations there.
A lot of times, the young children, that's all they look forward to. Is that 1 week or 2 weeks of vocational Bible school? Because some of these kids come from broken homes. And that's it. We start getting calls from there about the beginning of June, because they come around July, and they start calling. So when are they coming back? You know, when's vocational Bible school? So we tell them they'll be here about the first or second week in July, so that we always see that. And they look forward to it. These are the kids. That's all they have. For some of these kids, that's all they can look forward to. The best time of their lives is when they're ministered to in the Word of God. And so we went down there and we explained that to them, and they really enjoyed that. We were there a few days. But I tell you, I couldn't stand the weather, you know. It was so hot. Couldn't breathe there. Anyway, we're going to give it a try, get a go. Let's do there is a fountain in Cree, okay? Woodley Cree. Now we've had some singing people from way down south. Now let's do something from way up north, okay? You can join us.
Spirit.
sinners plunge beneath that flood and they lose all their guilty stains. Debwetan, Jesus, and gin botamak. Evangi, agishiganan umoko. Like he poured out his blood so that can be made pure in the sight of, in his sight. That way, sometimes the way English is written, when we translate it to our language, it has more meaning. Like it's direct, like this one, the one we just sang, you know. Like it says here, where was that one? Yeah, this one, they lose all their guilty stains. Sinners plunge, you know. It's like you jump in, and that's how it comes out in that translation. The precious blood of Jesus, and we're cleansed from all our sin. We're gonna do another one. We can't sing all of this, but we'll do maybe three more. And on our last one, I'm gonna ask some of our church ladies that are here, so I'm gonna invite them to come and join us. Another song here, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. It's got a beautiful message here. When I look at the cross, kaganap ang daman, yung mga Jesus kagitistakas. You know, when I look at that cross where Jesus died, that's so precious for. Can you imagine? Can you imagine back then when the gospel was being taken to the north? And they hear songs like that, you know, that have powerful meaning to them. It's not like today where we sing songs just because we love singing them. But people who heard for the first time the songs and the hymns had an impact on their lives. And this is one of them I really enjoy.
Jesus.
this song, when I survey the wonders cross, when I see what God, Jesus Christ, has done for me on the cross, you know, everything that I have, everything, I lay it all before Jesus. Jesus. And I hope we can pray that prayer and just do that, eh? And say, Lord, everything I have is yours. I'll tell you a little story. You know, years ago I was telling this story before I got saved. I fell off the boat while I was drinking in the middle of a lake. And there was a time where I go to places by boat, and that's to another part of the reserve. 5 o'clock in the morning, I go home. I was drinking. And somewhere between my place and the place where I took off from, I fell off the boat. I remember coming up out of the water, and my boat was just kept going. And it's the last thing I remember. And next thing I remember, I woke up in my bed in the morning, about 11 o'clock that morning. And I checked the door. Sure enough, my clothes were there, wet. And I was kind of thinking what happened there. And I went down to the lake, checked my boat. My boat was pulled up. I don't know who did that. I couldn't do it. To this day, I never heard a story about that incident. I'm still questioning that. But you know, that's the story of our lives, where we are lost, and I was lost. And everything, I could have lost everything, even my life. I was ruining my life. When I gave my heart to Jesus, I said, Lord, here's my life. I'm just destroying this life. You have it. It's yours. And that's what we need to do. Lord, here's my life. Look after it for me. And I hope you have that too. That desire too. When you realize that, you know, living our own lives, you kind of destroy it along the way. There was a song that I guess they didn't print it. I forgot to print it here. But anyway, there's another song that I wanted to do. It's called, one of the favorite hymns of our time is That Sings My Soul. But here it is. How Great Thou Art is number 2 on this one. Okay. Most of us that live up north, we see the beauty of God's creation. We go outside, I go outside anyway, and I see trees and stuff like that. I live by a lake there, a back lake, and God always reminds me when I sit and having my devotion just by my window there. God always reminds me of His goodness, that He created everything. And there's places that we've gone, I guess. Some of you have traveled and you've seen the wonders of God's creation, the mountains, you know, and places like that. And you just worship God. You know, that's all we can do. God speaks through His creation. And we say, you know, that God is there. You can join us on this one. Que se mandou o gato vinte de ano. Thank you.
Come on.
Sing together one more song with you. And, okay, Papa's Abhijay, Agishmaya Gimagi, and Natty, and Ellen here, Margaret, and whoever is from Garden Hill can come and join us. Hello, Shige Gibida, Donna, and we've got a little song, Garden Hill. Okay, Irene. Okay, offering, yes, I forgot. Offering, we'll do this. Because there's a coming a day. Number three, okay. We'll do our offering too at the same time. Mr. Bijet. We have some people from Garden Hill. Often they come join us. There seems to be more and more and more coming from Garden Hill. They fly to Winnipeg and drive this way. So we're going to do a... There is coming a day. So the offering plate is here. You know, today might be the day, you know, when Jesus will come. So if you have money in your pocket, you're going to leave it behind, okay? You're just going to leave it right here, okay? Florence. Where's Florence? Where's Florence? She's from there. All right. We're so glad to be here again this year now. Yeah, where's Lily? Okay. Florence is not around? All right. Okay, I guess we can do it without her. Right. There is coming a day. We're going to do it in Cree, so follow along. Everybody knows the English version of this song.
Thank you.
next year the band will be here this evening. We'll sing again this evening. Okay, good morning, everybody.
Have a word of prayer yet, and just thank God and bless God for the offering this morning. Heavenly Father, we just thank you and we bless you for being our Father, for being our Daddy, and for just caring for us and for your protection over us this weekend. We thank you for this blessing that you've blessed us with through this offering. I just pray that you would just richly bless each one that gave and all that are here this weekend. Father, we just want to honor you and bless you as you provide and see for our needs that we have as we journey through our life. We just pray that you would continue to help us to walk faithfully with you, that we would look to you for every need that we have, and that our walk would daily be of faith with you, that we would look to you moment by moment in whatever we face. So Father, we just want to commit the rest of this weekend to you, to be used for your honor and for your glory, and to make your name great in all that we do. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Amen. Our speaker for this morning, Huron, Claus, can come up. Everybody knows Huron, Claus. If you don't know him, come and talk to him. He has all the answers from the Bible.
Yes.
Word of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, I think at this time, too, the children is going to be going to the children's church, I believe it is. And we're going to take a little time to kind of set up, okay? And as we do that, I just want to say my heart's already blessed. I'm ready to go home already. But I want to share a message, and as we set up, I think we'll go ahead and do that, okay? We need to get the PowerPoint set up. I think that's what we're going to do. But as they're doing that, and then I think there's a... Well, I'll use this mic, okay, instead of the head thing. I'll do that. Okay. If I can get another one here. Okay. Plug that in. If you can find a plug for this, this will get you. Okay. Set up. Well, I've really enjoyed this morning already, the worship time. I feel like I've been to heaven and back, okay? And I always get blessed by Arnold. I've been up there at Garden Hill to minister. And when I first met Arnold, I had to look twice because I know another native indigenous person that looks just like Arnold. And I said, Arnold, I says, I know your twin. And he says, oh yeah? He says, well, I'll pray for him, he said. And I said, he's in Guatemala. He's about the same height. I says, he looks the same. And he's ministering to about 2.3 million among his people. And so every time I see Arnold, I think of that. And it's a joy because I've ministered with him, and just to hear the way that he preaches and communicates blesses my heart. So, let's see, let me get this going. Let's see if I can do this. And anyways, just the way he was explaining, I could already see he was blessed by his own language of praising the Lord. And I understand that, you know. In fact, when that was being, when he was singing, of course, How Great Thou Art and all of that, it reminded me of another service. And a lot of times I think of this. When I'm speaking, I think of different places that I've been to. And I want to sing a song for you this morning. And this is comes from the Seminole tribe. They are the only native tribe that never ever signed a peace treaty with the U.S. government. And they live in Florida. And what a blessing it is to be with them. You can check and see how that. Okay. And in this song, it reminded me, in this song, it says, we come from many different languages, okay? We come from many different tribes. And I was thinking of this as we were singing in English and OG Cree, you know, and even too, when Arnold said, what a blessing it must have been for our native people to hear these hymns being sung for the first time. If you can imagine the message behind that. And so, anyways, in this song, it says, we come from many different languages. We come from many different tribes, many different people groups. But you know what? When we get to heaven, we're going to speak one language. We're going to sing one song. And you know what that is? That is the hallelujah language and the hallelujah song. And that's, listen to this. Well, listen, and how this goes. That's the translation of the song. This is Seminole. It goes like this. Hallelujah, Hagagits, hallelujah, hallelujah, Hagagits, hallelujah. Mikotsa pogits my mana pogits hallelujah. Mikotsa pogits my mana pogits hallelujah. Hallelujah, ya, Hagagits, hallelujah, hallelujah, ya, Hagagits, hallelujah. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, okay, before we hear from his word. Father, we just consider it a privilege to be here today. We thank you, Lord, for your presence. We know that you're here right now, Lord. And Father, we know that you're pleased when you hear the songs, when you hear the languages. And Father, today it's for you. It's to give you glory and to give you praise, Father. And Lord, I can imagine what that day must be like when John was writing. And he said, every nation, every tribe, every tongue will come and they will give you praise and lift up their voices and cry out, worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Lord, what a meeting that's going to be. So Father, today this is just a touch of that. And Father, I just pray, God, that you would, again, just speak to us through the power of the word, and we'll give all the glory and praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Does it look like this is going to work? Or? Okay. Okay, I'm going to have to bring up this over.
Today, what I want to talk to you about, and if you have your Bibles, I want you to turn to the book of Hebrews, okay? And as I've been sharing these past couple times, really what I want us to see as Native people, I know a lot of us, when we go and we share Christ with our families, when we share Christ with our people, and even as God calls us to go to other nations, other tribes, I know it's a challenge because I face that every time I go. And a lot of times I hear the response, well, Huron, that's okay for you, okay? This book is a white man's book. Christianity is the white man's religion. We have our own way of worship, and I hear that a lot. But you know what? I've learned in my walk with the Lord that we've got to remember that the Bible is God's word to all his creation, okay? I'm constantly reminded of this. Is as you read in Scripture, in Genesis, where God created, and when I have these conversations with our native people, of course, they say, we believe in the Creator, okay? They have high regard for the Creator. But when we talk about Jesus, it seems like there's a wall there, and the lights go out, and the communication begins to stop. But you know what? As I look in Scripture, I see that God's word is for his creation, and it's for all peoples, all nations, all tribes. And so I want you to see here, and this is as I look throughout Scripture, I see our native people in Scripture, okay? When I look at Scripture, and I can give you examples, when I look at Scripture, I saw when God chose Abram, which was Abraham, he chose a man that was tribal. He came from a tribe. As I read on, I read that he's a part of a nation that had 12 tribes, okay? When I look in the Old Testament and see all their ways of worship, I see, again, very similar among our native people. You have the different festivals that take place. And even to the spiritual leaders, when I stop and look at the people of Israel, I see the role of the high priest and how he is the leader among his people. And when I went to Israel, that was interesting. I was just talking to a brother this morning that had gone to Israel. And he had asked me, he says, Huron, you said you had gone to Israel. I said, yes, I've been there 3 times. And I remember in 1992, we took 10 Native American pastors and leaders from Alaska, from Canada, from U.S., from Latin America, and we went to Israel there. We were invited by the country there. And we were all dressed up in our Indian regalia, and nobody told us there that we could not literally talk about Jesus, lift up the name of Jesus. So we were sharing Jesus with everybody, okay? We were speaking with the mayor of Jerusalem, the mayor of rabbis, and we were talking about Christ and how Christ had made a difference in our lives. I was amazed of the similarities. There in the Old Testament, when you see the high priest and you see all the ceremonies, when I was in Israel, they told me there were over 640 ceremonies, practices that the high priest would practice. That was amazing. And I thought of our native people. I thought of my people, the Kiowas, where, again, among the Kiowas, the Comanches, the Apaches. And I know you hear of the Native American church, the Peyote religion. That was established among my mother's people. And that has impacted nations. So, and I know that among our native ways, we have traditions, we have ceremonies, we have practices, just like what I see that has taken place. And in Scripture, when I see Scripture, I see where it was not a majority that God chose, but they were a minority. They were small. And God said in Scripture, I've chosen you not because you're great, but because you're small. And it was because he chose a minority people that he lifted up his name and he brought glory to the whole world. And so in passages I see our Native people, and that's what I was sharing these past couple days or times that I've been with you. When I think of a cultural letter, when I think of a leader that is writing to his people, I think of this book of Hebrews, okay? And today I want to just take about 30 minutes, if I can, 40 minutes, and I want to share with you, okay? And if you'll watch on this screen, this was very interesting. As I study the Bible, I see different letters that Paul wrote. And Hebrews was actually not written by Paul, but it was written, it was a cultural letter, okay? As we study this book, and I want to talk about this, okay, is, let me just bring this out. Some of the questions is, who was the writer of this letter, okay? Well, they really don't know. A lot of people say that it was the Apostle Paul that wrote the letter. But those that study this letter, they said, you know, it's not written the same way that Paul writes the letter. Usually he acknowledges he's the writer. Usually, and that's not what takes place here. So the question is, who wrote the letter? Some of the leaders say, well, it was Paul. And they say, no, it's really not the style of Paul. Others say, well, you know, it was Barnabas. And who was Barnabas? Well, it was a partner in Paul's ministry. And I love, again, here's another example, native example, because Barnabas, he was one that traveled with Paul, and his name meant something. In the Jewish way, when you give a name to an individual, it tells something about them or their character. And in Barnabas, the name is called Son of Encouragement, okay? And you see this. In Paul's ministry, Barnabas came alongside, and he was an encourager. That's what it means, Son of Encouragement. It reminds me of our people. It reminds me of my own people, the Kylos. My name, I shared this earlier. My name is Huron Claus, okay? That's what I'm known when I go around. But when I go back to my people, my mother's people, the Kiowas, my name, they don't call me Huron. They call me Kesaw, okay? Kesaw. And the reason why I'm called Kesaw, because I was born at 12 o'clock noon on Thanksgiving Day, November 23rd, okay? So my grandfather, when I was about 11 or about 12 years old, we all got together. And my grandfather said, from now on, Huron, you will be known as Kesaw. You know what that means? That means at noon, okay? That tells about me, at noon. I always say I'm glad my grandpa called me at noon. He could have called me Turkey, but he didn't, okay? But that's our way. See, it tells something about them. So here, Barnabas, he was a son of encouragement. He was a minister partner with Paul. Some people say Barnabas wrote this. Others, and you read about this, Paul was quite a preacher, quite a teacher, but there was another man by the name of Apollos. And again, among the people, they would get behind these different leaders and they would say, well, I'm a follower of Paul, or have you heard Barnabas, or have you heard Apollos? Man, when Apollos speaks, it's incredible to hear him. And so some were saying, well, Apollos wrote this letter. Others were saying, no, there's another ministry partner. He was a doctor. And when he wrote his letters, he's very detailed in his writing. It was Dr. Luke that actually wrote. And all these individuals that they're talking about are Jews, okay? All of these individuals that whoever wrote this letter, it was a Jewish, now listen to this, it was a Jewish writer writing to his people, the Jews. So it was a cultural letter. And in fact, when you read this letter, you see some of the things that he talks about. It talks about the culture of his people. So he didn't have to go into explanation like what I'm doing today. He didn't have to explain. He talked about different things of the high priest and sacrifices. And he didn't have to go into detail because he was speaking to the people that knew his culture. So what I'm saying is that the writer was a Jew, okay? Others were saying even Priscilla and Aquila possibly could have wrote this letter. But what we know really is we don't know who wrote the letter. What we know is that it was a Jewish writer. And you know what? I thought this was really interesting because I asked myself, well, why don't we know who the writer is, you know? And I think my thoughts are when this letter was written, Hebrews, it didn't matter who the author was. It didn't matter who the speaker is. You know what mattered? It was the message that needed to get across. And so this is the book of Hebrews. I want you to see this. I want you to look at who the people were that this writer was writing to. Okay, we know that if he was a Jewish writer, he was writing to his people, a cultural letter, he was writing to the Jews. And as I studied the Jews in this time, you know what? They were under persecution. They were under oppression. In fact, Rome was a world leader. Rome was the majority. The Jews were a minority. And so when you look at the Jews, they were going through great difficulty by the Romans. What the writer says in here, and you might just want to write this down, some of you that's writing this, is in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 32 through 34. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 32 through 34. And the writer writes this. Okay, now I want you to understand, this is the people. This is what they were going through. The writer says, remember those early days after you had received the light. Now he's talking about the gospel. He says, you Jews that have heard about Jesus, you received the light when you endured in a great conflict full of suffering, okay? So they had, like I said last night, they had their challenges, they had their difficulties, they were going through their battles and physical battles. There were people that were losing their life for the sake of Christ. And then he went on to say, sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. At other times you stood side by side with those that were so treated, mistreated. That way, you suffered along with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property. So even their land, even their homes were taken. And I thought, boy, if I didn't know any better, they must have been native people, okay? But that's scripture, Hebrews here. It goes on and says, because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions, okay? So they had the right perspectives. Now, as the writer is writing, as he's communicating this message to his people, they were persecuted. They were persecuted from the outside. They were persecuted from the inside, okay? Rome was the greatest enemy, okay? But they were also persecuted by their own people because there, as this letter was written, and this is what really interests me, okay, is why did the writer write this letter? Because the letter he was writing to, the people were probably a second generation of followers of Jesus Christ. And you know what? The whole issue of this book, I'm drawing a picture here for you because I want to encourage you to study the book of Hebrews. The reason why the writer was writing to his people, because this young church, this young group of believers were considering to go back to their traditional ways, their Jewish ways, and their practice. And so as the writer begins to speak, he is encouraging. And what I want you to see, and this is what I want to really focus on today, he says the most important thing in our walk with the Lord is Jesus Christ, okay? In fact, Arnold didn't even know it, but he was preaching my message, okay? When he said, We got to give up everything, you know. We've got, and it's not a negative thing. It's like it's such a love relationship that you experience with Jesus Christ that you're willing. It's like Paul says, you know what? I've discovered the greatest value, the greatest possession is knowing Jesus Christ. And all these other things, they don't matter. It's just like Jesus when he said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all these things will be added unto you. That's what this writer is saying in Hebrews, okay? So let me just briefly talk about this, okay? Huron, how does Hebrews relate to our native people? Well, let's look at these two verses, or three verses I want to look at, beginning with chapter 1. Listen to what it says. God, after he spoke long ago to our fathers or our ancestors in the prophets, in many portions and in many ways, in these last days has spoken to us in his Son. Okay, I just want to stop there. That is the whole message to Hebrews, okay? He's saying, just like David said, and I was preaching about this the other night, is that God spoke to us. He spoke to us through creation. You look at the stars and the moons, and what this leader is saying is that God spoke to us through our ancestors. He spoke to us through our leaders in the past. But you know what? In these last days, it's important, in these last days, he is speaking to us through his Son. That is the pinnacle of his letter, okay? Now, as he begins to write this letter, and I want you to see this, in Hebrews chapter 1, the end of chapter 1, and the beginning of chapter 2, he starts talking about angels, okay? He starts focusing on angels. And you know what? As I looked at the Jewish people, they believed in angels. The angel of the Lord spoke to them in the Old Testament. The angel of the Lord was the one that declared that the Messiah is coming. It was the angels that came and spoke to them through visions. And so you see that angels were very important within the Jewish culture. You know, as I look at this as a Native American, you know what also I observed? It's speaking about the spirit world. And I thought, you know what? Just like the Jews, among our Native people, we have high regard in the spirit world. I teach in the book of Ephesians, and I love that because there's another example. I say that there's four relationships that the writer writes there. And he says that our relationship with God is important. Our relationship with our neighbor is important. Our relationship with our family is important. And in Ephesians chapter 6, he says our relationship with the spirit world is important. And that was thousands of years ago when that was written. And I said, you know what? When I sit down and talk to our native people, they believe in those four key relationships. God, my neighbor, my family, the spirit world. When I look at Hebrews here, he's saying, and just briefly, what he does is he begins to talk about the angels, about the spirit world. And you know what's taking place among his people is that the Jewish people they have such high regard for the angels, the messengers of God, that they were lifting up the role of the spirit world even higher than Jesus. And what the writer was saying is, let's look at what we value. And you know what? The greatest value should be Jesus Christ, not the spirit world. So he was having them consider what we value most in life. That's in chapter 1, okay? In chapter 3 in Hebrews, as you begin to read that, the writer is writing about They're leaders. The writer is writing about Moses and how Moses was a great leader among his people. And he was considered with great honor, great respect. And you read about that in chapter 3. You know what it reminds me of? It reminds me of my travels when I've gone and I've visited different tribes and I've met descendants of different leaders. I was sharing the other day when I was among the Lakota Sioux in Pine Ridge just 3 months ago. I had met the last living descendant of Sitting Bull, okay? And it was amazing to realize she was a believer in Jesus Christ. When I've been in Florida and ministered among the Seminoles there, I go and I have a meal and fellowship with great Christian friends there, the Osceolas. And they, Osceola was a great leader among the Seminoles. And in this letter, when the writer is writing about Moses, he is actually looking at his heritage, the heritage of their people, the legacy of their people. And one of the greatest leaders among their people was Moses. And the writer writes about this. So you know what? In this cultural letter, what he was saying is, you know, young believers, young church, we are lifting up our heritage. We are lifting up our people, our ancestry. But you know what is the greatest? Is we need to lift up Jesus. Jesus is what we need to focus on. You go on and you read chapter 5 of Hebrews, okay? Chapter 5. And what the writer is writing about is the role of the high priest, okay? He talks about the high priest. And like I was saying earlier, when you look at the practices of the high priest, there's a lot of ceremony that takes place. And what the Jews were doing in that day and time, they were actually lifting up the ceremonies of their people more than the person and the work of Jesus. So over and over and over again, the writer is saying the most important part, the supreme importance, is to know Jesus. And then the last one that I want to bring out is in Hebrews chapter 10, okay? Hebrews chapter 10. And what you see there is it talks about the sacrifices of his people. And you know, you see the festivals, you see all the different practices among the Jewish people, and there were sacrifices that took place. What it reminds me again is of our own people. I think of my own Mohawk people. Usually in February, they have the white dog ceremony. And I remember hearing about that in the longhouse is where they would gather. Usually the women were on one side and the men were on the other side. And right at the very center of the longhouse, there was a white dog without spot or blemish. They had ribbons that were tied around them. And the spiritual leader, the medicine man, would go into days of practice, but at the height of the practice, he would take a knife and he would pierce the throat of that dog. And as the blood was shed, then he would pray to God. And they practiced that year after year after year. 2 weeks from now, like I mentioned, I'm going to be in Montana. When I was in among the Lakota Sioux, that was one thing that they told me there. They will be practicing the Sundance in over 200 ceremonies just on the Lakota reservation, where they worship, they pray to the sun. They practice that every year. You know what the writer was writing in Hebrews chapter 10? When Jesus Christ went to the cross and he shed his blood, the Son of God, for all mankind, that was once and for all and never had to be done again. And again, if you understand the message to the Jewish people, he was saying, you know what, people, loved ones, we have lifted up the ceremonies, the sacrifices above the ultimate sacrifice of Jesus Christ. for all mankind. So that's the message of Hebrews, okay? Now, believe it or not, that's not even my message, okay? We could go into this all day, but let me just hit it, okay? Let me just hit it. You know what the theme of this letter is? When the writer is writing, he says, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus is the answer, okay? To all our questions, Jesus is the solutions. I had a friend, and he was a musician, and he wrote this song. He said, Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him, there's no other. Jesus is the way. And I always think about that. So this writer is saying that Jesus is supreme. There's no other greater. There's no other answer. And yet, how often do we go and try to find the answers to our solution? So let me just hit this real quick, okay? Is in the past, well, let me go on. I'm going to even pass this here. But God spoke to us, okay? And he spoke. When you stop and think, let me just hit this real quick, okay? There's so much here. But when you look in Genesis chapter 1, God spoke. And if you look at Genesis chapter 1, you'll see 9 times when God spoke, creation was made. You know what that really shows me too? Is that God communicates to his creation. You know what I would encourage you as Native people? You know what? We need to communicate. I was saying one of the things that we don't do is we don't talk unless this is necessary. But you know what? I think we need to talk. Because when we talk, God talks to us, okay? So what I would say is that what you see in Genesis 1 is God spoke, okay, through his creation. Creation was made. In Deuteronomy chapter 4, when you see Mount Sinai, what a tremendous picture is God is speaking to his people. When you see the 10 commandments communicated to his people, God spoke to them. They remembered that. And then, like I said last night, when God said to Moses, I want you to build a tent for me. And that was a tabernacle. And you know, what a great place. Because it was at God's tent, it was at God's teepee that God spoke to his people. Now, again, I think of pictures. I'm a picture person. When Moses went across the wilderness, a lot of times I think this was a great gathering. We had here, I don't know how many hundreds of people here. But when Moses went across the wilderness, you know that there was estimated 1.5 million to 2 million people. And they were in 12 tribes. And right in the center of their encampment, there was a tent, a tabernacle. And when God came, now if you can picture this, we have our meetings. And when God came to the Jewish people in the daytime, he came by cloud. There was a cloud that hovered over that tent. As we sing and we praise the Lord in the evening when it's dark, when they had their tabernacle, God came in the form of fire. But it was God's presence. God spoke to their people. What an incredible sight that took place. But God spoke to them. He spoke to their ancestors. He spoke to men like Abraham. He spoke to men like Moses. He spoke to men like Isaac. He spoke to leaders like Jacob. And I think among our Native people, you know what? God still speaks to us today. He speaks to leaders, generations. When I think of the generations here in Canada, when I was a little boy, there were men like Bill Jackson, and Tommy Francis, and individuals like that I think of. He spoke to those men, and he's speaking today. He's speaking to individuals like Arnold and Kenny Jackson, some of these others. We see that. He spoke to our ancestors, but he also spoke to the prophets in the Old Testament. He spoke to Daniel, Ezekiel, Isaiah, Jeremiah. But then what you see, and it says that God spoke to us in various ways, okay? He spoke through the angel of the Lord, you hear in the Old Testament. He spoke to the people of Israel. He spoke, he revealed himself, he revealed his character to people through dreams. He did it also through visions. He did it also through miracles. But you know what? In all of that, God was revealing himself. And in all that time, when you look at the Bible, when I look at God's word from the Old Testament to the New Testament, there is over 1,400 years of time that God has spoke to his people. He spoke through different people groups, but the message is all the same. The message is about Jesus, okay? And that's what amazes me, is you see that. That was the past, how he spoke. But what you see in chapter 2 here, it says, but in these last days, okay? Now, I want you to see this. As the writer is writing to this brand new group of believers, this writer is saying, that's how God revealed himself to us. But you know what? In these present days, in these last days before Christ comes back to take his people, it says that he, God, has spoken to us by his son, Jesus. Okay. So the most important thing now in life is to hear the voice of Christ, the voice of God through Jesus Christ. So as you look at verse 2 and 3, the writer is writing about Jesus, okay? And this is how I want to close it. Take about 15 minutes, and I want you to look at this, okay? This is the writer. He's saying the most important thing is Jesus. He says, you know what, people? We get caught up in our life. We get caught up in our world, and we put things more important than Jesus. Among that people thousands of years ago, the spirit world was important. The ceremonies were important. The heritage was important. The sacrifices was important. But you know what? As he writes the letter, he says the most important thing in life, the most supreme individual in life is Jesus Christ, the Son of God. That's what he's saying, okay? So as he writes this letter, he writes about Jesus. And there are seven things that he writes about Jesus. And I want you to remember this, if anything, remember this. The first thing he says that he was appointed heir of all things, okay? He was heir of all things. What does that mean, okay? You know what? That means that he has the authority of all things, Jesus Christ. He owns it all, okay? There's no one greater than him. There's no one that has more than him. He is the heir of all things, and all things serve him. Okay. I have a friend. I had a friend, and she's gone home to be with the Lord. And we knew an individual by the name of Corey Ten Boom. Okay. Corey Ten Boom was from the Netherlands. She was Dutch. And it was during the times that the Nazi war was against the Jews, killing millions of Jews. And Corey, I remember her telling us this story about her and her family. And ultimately, during the same time, what she did, her family would protect the Jews and from going into prison camps, the Nazi prison camps. But one day, the Nazis found out that what her family was doing, and they put her father, her sister, herself in the Jewish prison camps. And she tells the story of the injustices that not only took place among the Jewish people, but the injustices that they experienced in protecting the Jews. She lost her father, she lost her mother in the camps there. And I'll never forget, and I know you've heard the story, of where God changed her life. She put her trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, and it was amazing how God used, I would say, like a grandma. She was everybody's grandma, okay? But this grandma would tell about the greatness of the Lord Jesus Christ. I remember, too, I'll never forget what she would say. She said there was times where I would go out and minister and share Christ with people all over the world. And she said, I had needs. And she says, you know what I would do is I would go and to a conversation with the Lord. And I would share my need with Jesus. And I would always have this conversation. Lord, you told me that you own the cattle on 1,000 hills. And you own it all. You are the heir of all things. So this is what I want to bring to you, my need today. And you know what she said? It was amazing how I saw the faithfulness of God and his provision, where he provided for the very need that I experienced in life. That's what Hebrews is saying. Jesus is the heir of all things. If he has authority over it all, do you realize that we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, and the very needs that we face, we can take to the Lord. And you know what? He meets those needs. So the first thing that this writer says is that Jesus is the heir of all things. You know what? The next thing he says is that Jesus is the creator of all things. Okay? And that really blew my mind as a Native American when I realized that. Because I was thinking of all the conversations among our Native people. And they said, we believe in the Creator. We believe, have high respect for him. There's things we do, there's things we don't do, because we have great honor for the Creator. But you know what? What they do not see is that Jesus Christ is the Creator of all things. Okay? And I say that if we come to recognize that he has created it all, okay? Now let me say this, and I watch my time, but you know what? He's created all of us. He's created the native, he's created the white man, the black man, the yellow man, all of us, okay? And so in our differences, in the atrocities that go on, and I wish I had time just to tell you about this, but I believe that in the end, Jesus will make it right, because he is the one, and I don't have time to go into all of this, but I remember talking to a social worker here in Canada, and she was Native, and she was a believer, and she was talking about the injustices that were taking place among our Native people, and she says, how do I explain this? And that's a difficult situation, let me say that. But you know what? In my conversation, now listen to this. I said to her, you know what? When I look at all the injustices, specifically among our Native people, and I look at scripture, and I see injustices, and I see atrocities, even in the Bible, the people of Israel, God blessed them with a name. God blessed them with a land. God blessed them with a place of worship, the tabernacle. But you read in scripture where all of that is gone. Their name is gone. Their land is gone. In Ezekiel, God leaves his presence from the tabernacle. And yet, so there's atrocities that take place. And you know what I find there? Now listen to this. Is in those times where there is injustice, you know what I observe? Listen. God's people are not listening to God's voice, okay? God's people are not reflecting God's character. because scripture tells me God is good, okay? When there's injustice, goodness is not there. What you see is the people of God not reflecting who Christ God is. I would say what that does for us, and it's a wake-up call, is are we reflecting the person and the work of God, Christ, in our lives? That's where we will see justice take place. So, anyways, he is the creator of all things. It goes on and says that he is the radiance of his glory, okay? He is the radiance of his glory. And what that means is he is the exact representation, he is the exact image of God. And scripture tells us that we can understand God. The only way we begin to see who God is when we see his son, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is that exact radiance of the image of God, okay? It goes on and says that he is the exact nature. Another thing that he says in the scriptures there, and I love this, not only did he create all things, but he upholds all things, okay? He upholds all things. You know what? He didn't just create and let it go. He upholds it all. He holds up the stars. He holds up the moon. All of that. That's wonderful. But you know what I even think of is even in our marriages, when we go through difficulties, you know what? He's the one that can uphold us in our marriages. What we need to do is look to Jesus. Look to Jesus. He fulfills all things. It goes on to say, and he finally completes all things. As I look at this letter, what I see the writer saying about Jesus, 7 times, he says, Jesus is the authority of all. Jesus is the master designer. Jesus is the very glory of God. Jesus never changes. Jesus knows all things. Jesus is the justifier of all. He's going to make it right in the end. And Jesus is all powerful. There's no greater power than him. That's what this letter is writing about. You know what? The question I want to ask you in closing is, what are your values in life? Okay? What is important in life? For the Jewish people, there were things that were important to them. The spirit world, the ceremonies, the sacrifices, the heritage. And those are okay, but you know what? The writer was saying we need to check our values. And the most important value that we can hold in life is to accept Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord of our lives. So I want to ask you today, have you made that kind of decision? I would encourage you, if you embrace Jesus that way, you are going to see how God is going to really align things up. So let's close in prayer, okay? And I want you to think about that. And I want to give you the opportunity really to respond, okay? So let's go to the Lord in prayer first. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we give you glory and praise. And Lord, this is just a reminder of what's most important in our lives. Lord, oft times I get so busy, I have things that I lose track of and realize that I've put them even before you. And Lord, I ask your forgiveness. Lord, I know that it's many times when I realize that, Father, that I need to reevaluate my life. And I want to make you first in my life. And Lord, it's just like Arnold said today, he nailed it, is that we got to give it all. We've just got to submit everything, Lord, to you. And so, Father, I just pray for each and every one today that we would think on that matter. Lord, are we just committing our all to you? Are we giving it all up and saying, Lord, you're the most important thing in my life? Father, I just pray, God, that if there are people here that are struggling with issues, struggling with problems, struggling with addictions, or whatever it may be, Lord, I pray, God, you are our healer. Lord, you have the power and authority to crush the spirit world. And Lord, all we have to do is to come to you. But yet so often, we hold back. We don't talk. We don't communicate. And so, Father, I just pray, oh God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that you would work in and through us. And Lord, I pray that you would draw whoever you want today, God. May they have that conversation with you. May they submit their all to you. So whether we are believers or not, Father, I just pray that we would just be submissive this day. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to have Clarence lead a song. And I just want to kind of make this an open time, that if you would want maybe prayer, a time of prayer, you come and to the altar and we'll have a brief time of prayer. For those that say, you know what, Huron's like you're speaking about me and I have not made that kind of decision, but I want today, I want to give you that opportunity to come up too. And I want to have, I can't do this by myself, okay? I want some of you pastors to come up. Arnold, I want you to come up and join me. Some of you pastors come up and help me in just this time of prayer, okay? So go ahead, you lead us. And this just opens, so once they get done singing, and after they get done singing, then we'll close. And I'll have Arnold close in prayer for us. Sky out there somewhere? Sky Meekis? We're going to sing a song called You Are My King.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. The Spirit is within me because you died. I'm accepted, you were condemned. Yeah.
Commitments. Let's all pray. Father in heaven, we praise you. We give thanks to you, Lord, for your mercy and your goodness to us. You are with us today, and we feel your presence, Lord, and just want to give praise to you for that, Lord. And just go before us, Lord, today, the rest of the day. Just be with each one here. And just continue to work in our lives, Lord, and the lives of people that hear the message, even on the radio, Lord. There's people out there listening and wanting to follow you. And they don't know how. And Father, I pray that you be there to meet them and as they pray unto the Almighty God. So I just want to commit everything to you. Bless us the rest of the day. In Jesus' name, amen.